Welcome to episode 130. I can't believe I've been doing this for 130 weeks. But today we are talking with author and businessman Aaron McCormick about how we know the difference between what our mind is telling us and what we actually want to do. We're making our way through the fog of life, and clarity is understanding where we are on the map. You are here.
Let the good times roll.
This is Clarity Compressed. 130 weeks. I can't believe it's been 130 weeks of releasing a podcast every week. I don't know if there's anything else that I've done consistently more than this podcast, other than mess things up. I've messed things up for 130 weeks, for sure. But I've done the podcast. I'm happy to be with you today. If you're new to the audience, I know we had some big live streams last week. If you're new to the audience, welcome. I hope that being a part of this community, listening to the podcast when you can, brings you a level of personal clarity and perspective of where you are. And my goal is really through the podcast is to free up some thinking in your mind and kind of take away some of the limitations that we put on ourselves. And this week's guest, Aaron McCormick, I think is a great way to do that. So Aaron, very, very successful businessman. He was the top salesman at IBM. He grew up in the south side of Chicago, real rough area, transcended a number of hurdles to make his way into the sales ranks of like real high-end technology, like mission critical technology. And as an African-American man, even more rare in that industry. So this is just somebody that understands how to think. And he wrote a book called Unbounded, The Journey to Your Within. We discuss the book and we talk about the way we naturally hear and put these psychological limits on what we should believe or what we think we should believe. And we get to the bottom of, well, we start to talk and work through a little bit how often that internal, we do the separation between mind and the heart, and this internal heart, this internal like knowledge of, you know, what we feel like we really should be doing versus what other people tell us we should be doing. We get into that, and I think it's even more relevant in this day and age when we've had all kinds of unrest. We're in an election year when we have all these voices telling us what we should believe, what we should do. We grow up, we come through high school and college and our adult life with other people telling us what we should believe, what we should do. So how do we get through all that noise? And look, it's not something we're going to solve on this podcast. It is going to be an age-old problem. However, I hope that this conversation and Aaron's perspective on it helps you get a little bit more clarity on what are you believing because other people are telling you should believe, and actually what do you feel is the right way to go because your convictions are driving you that way. So we get into that and a lot more in this interview. I hope you enjoy meeting Aaron. I sure did. And hopefully this brings us another step forward on the path of clarity. So here's the interview. Aaron, thank you so much for joining us on the show today and sharing some of your time and insights with the Clarity Compressed audience.
Thanks for having me, Paul. Look forward to it.
So tell me, where are you? Everybody's kind of dialing from home these days. And where are you dialing in from? What part of the country?
West Coast, Southern California.
Oh, man, West Coast. You didn't grow up in the West Coast, though, right?
No, in some ways I wish I did because I was super into BMX as a kid and all that cool stuff happened here.
Yeah.
But no, I'm from Chicago. That's my home.
Do you remember the movie Rad?
Of course.
I haven't thought about that movie in probably 20 years, but when I was a kid, like that was all we watched. And I grew up on the East Coast too. I grew up in Philly. So little more of a BMX culture in Southern California than Chicago.
Very crazy. And to give you a little tidbit for you to go into after the show, one of the songs on the soundtrack, Break the Ice, is a very deep song. Has nothing to do with BMX.
Get out of here.
It has more to do with the soul journey, entrepreneurship, breaking through stuff that normally confines and scares the shit out of you, all that. It's a very interesting song. So take a listen.
All right. Yeah. All right, talking about coming out swinging. We're all the way back to the movie Rad and a deep song that was on the soundtrack. I'm looking that up for sure. Could you give us like the quick few minute version of your story where you've come from? Like I know people read bios and I'll try to talk about in the intro, but it's always best coming from the person who represents it. Who is it? So like if you could just give us a few minutes before we get back into that, how you can tell.
So that's ironic. I always think it's better when someone else says it because I hate talking about myself that
way. Oh, no, that's good. I want to hear from you. I've already read it.
You read it. So let's see if we go. Background. I'm raised on South Side of Chicago, raised by a single mom. I have four siblings. by the time I was about 2021, I began earning hundreds of thousands of dollars a year in tech sales. So really complex, departmental, mission critical in some cases. So call it supply chain, ERP-like stuff as enterprise resource planning, modular multi-million dollar solutions that I sold to the C-suite. So this is CIO, COO, presidents, you know, all over the board. And I learned at a very young age the importance of empathy. But largely my journey is it's not unique. What makes it unique is that I've connected dots about my own journey. All of us have a very unique and incredible reason why we're here, and it's a puzzle for us to connect. And it all comes down to our clarity of connecting this with that and seeing how everything we've been through has served us because we designed it, basically. So in the physical, Paul, ironically, I'm ambidextrous in very odd ways. And you alluded to the book in that I was very secularly successful, all this without an undergrad. So I'm black in America. I was raised on the south side of Chicago, the crime capital. And by 20, I'm making hundreds of thousands. I've got a $1 million house at 25 or 24 years old that I built. And then here I am now at 43, and I've released a book that is a bridge of sorts, just like being ambidextrous, left brain, right brain. It's connecting the physical stuff, the business, the success on that front, or love relationships, all the things we think are physical and external to us, to it really being something that's very much a part of what we've always been, if you can, you know, connect the dots, become more congruent.
No, understood. Okay, and just tell me, because I have to know, this part wasn't in the bio, or you didn't just tell us. Yeah. How did you make the jump from South Side of Chicago, right? Like, what was the path that got you into that even world to begin with? Like, how did you get into that industry? How did you get into those companies? Like, fill in that blank. It's a big blank right there.
Yeah, right, because the industry, the tech industry, is already very absent of specific types of minorities, black and Mexican to be specific. Lots of Indian, lots of Asian. In some ways, some would say it's diverse in that respect. Mm-hmm. But on the sales side, it's even more absent of any color. Mm-hmm. And logically, because you're selling to senior executives, which are typically, of course, mature middle-aged white men.
Yep.
And so people tend to like and feel comfortable with what is like them.
Sure.
So most minorities, whether they're competent or not, they don't want to deal with that hurdle. So they would immediately go, I'd rather go where I can exceed purely on my merit. I'll be in accounting and I'll become the director of finance and blah, blah, or I'll be, you know, director of customer care. And so there's plenty of blacks and other minorities that may do okay in those aspects. What on earth made me pick sales, which is like no man's land? It certainly wasn't. Well, it was here, but it was also driven largely by the heart. So as an example, I was also raised in a very fundamentalist Christian religion. I forgot that piece. And the purpose, the importance of that is we were highly discouraged from career greatness. Because if it's fundamentalist, that means you follow Christ to a T, right? And Christ, the story of Christ, perfect human, could have been the most affluent, pick an industry, right? Mm-hmm. And the best leader, the best king, he chose to be a lowly carpenter. So the point is, I was raised to not be thinking of ever becoming rich or ever becoming successful.
Profit is evil.
No college.
I understand. This podcast is a lot about getting perspective on where you are in the map. It's called Clarity Compressed. My view of the word clarity is really it comes when you have perspective and you understand like where you're heading. You understand where you're heading, but you also understand where you are on that journey. And that's what gives you the insight that can keep you going, keep you motivated, understand that maybe you need to course correct or change a little bit. So I thought you'd be a great guest because you come from a really robust business background and done some amazing things in the world of business, but you've also just released a book and you talk a lot about how to get yourself right so that you can execute better in family and in business and all that. So why don't you tell us a little bit about the book and you know, what brought you to the point of writing it?
Yeah, sure. So the book is called Unbounded, Journey to Your Within. So it's very much a book almost by the reader, right? You're like, how is that? The reader didn't write it. But it's really meant to take the reader through their own series of events, experiences, their memory as baby toddlers, if you will, on through various parts of life, including the current. And it's really designed to help the reader connect the two parts of us that are typically somewhat at odds and disparate, and that is the mind. So the human ego, which are the things that we've learned since we were born, the things we've absorbed from our community, our parents, our bigger siblings, TV, pop culture, everything. Those mm-hmm. are all things that come into us since we enter the world, and try to integrate that or try to, I guess, sort it to understand how it is impacting for good and for perceived bad. I say perceived because I really believe everything serves us. But the perceived bad is really just internal conflict. So there's that other side of us, the opposite of the mind, the ego, which is the heart. Two biggest organs of the body, but also the heart is the figurative, spiritual, or energetic disposition, the unspoken things that we are or are not. And we proceed to allow the things we learn to run our life. And we're living, all of us are living in various levels of conflict, from relationships and friendships to our career, things we spend time on. We don't realize it, but we're in conflict. And it's about figuring out how to detect your own internal conflict so that you become congruent. And I use that word.
I'll take it.
You become a lot more congruent in your essence and in your experience. And of course, that delves a lot into business, since that is the bulk of where most of our time goes usually. Mm-hmm. And time is our most valuable asset.
Well, I think that right there, I mean, like, talk about just taking a splash in the pool right away. I mean, it's a cannonball. I think that most people understand that there is a conflict, unless they're completely disconnected, you know, and completely disconnected ego, completely disconnected, you know, emotionally. I think everyone, I know I'm very aware of this level of conflict between what my head and what my heart are constantly trying to negotiate. You said, you know, the mind and the heart. Would you consider those two things, like, what some people call that nature and nurture? Like, nurture is what you've learned and nature is how you were, your natural disposition. Is it similar to that?
Very similar. In fact, I allude to how we, our original spark or essence, the God spark. One thing I've noticed about all religion all throughout history is that it's believed that we are all connected with God. We're one with God. Doesn't matter whether it's Buddhist, Hindu, Christian, Muslim, there's one common thread, and that God is love and we're a piece of it. So a piece of God, we are this ubiquitous energy. So the book is in no way religious. It doesn't really get into God per se in that context, but mm-hmm. it's highly spiritual in that it's forcing you to notice the different ways that that unspoken nature, as you called it, is at work within us mm-hmm. and how, you know, what is the cause and effect of us obeying, heeding and listening in those times where we did versus those times where we didn't out of fear. And it really comes down to this tangible calculation, Paul. It's like in every situation, the conflict hits us. And it's good that you said you're conscious of it. Many people, we've gotten so used to following this and the fear of going against this mm-hmm. that you don't even notice the conflict most of the time. But the calculation basically is an event comes up, a proposition comes up, an opportunity comes up, a conversation, an expectation, a pressure, whatever it is, comes up, peer level, business level, job, whatever, the relationship, and your initial calculation or your two options are either I listen to this one, which will result in, or if I go against this one, which is the fear of a breaking up with somebody that you're not comfortable with, or leaving a job or industry that you spent a lot of time cultivating or in education, but it's not fully right, whatever the case may be.
And so when you say going against this one, I'm just going to specify for anyone that might just be listening, he's pointing to his head. So he's like going against yes. what's in your mind.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The fear, the thing that you've learned that's a no-no, mm-hmm. right? So you don't undo a relationship at 35 years old, 36 years old, you're a woman or you're a man and you're like, I don't want to keep starting all over, or I don't want to shift careers, or I don't want to say no to this given group of friends in this setting. I disagree with all the narrative that they're talking about. So the point is, the calculation, Paul, is which is more fearful to me? Here's how you really determine whether or not you are more mind focused, meaning you follow the ego mind, ego not meaning I'm a big shot. Ego is also interchanged with the human journey, the human things that we've learned
yep.
versus when you refer to nature, it's the God aspect. It's that unspoken thing that's always been with you mm-hmm. since before you learned to be who you are. The point there is when you're faced with the crossroad of if I go against the physical things I've learned, the mind aspect, I'll have some really tangible repercussions. I'll have friends that look at me funny, talk about me. I'll be single, or I'll be unemployed, or I'll have to worry about this, or tangible.
Yep.
Versus if I go against the heart aspect, I won't like it very much, but I don't get, I don't shift my income or money. I don't get ridicule. I don't. So there's this immediate, you know, decision we make, and more often than not, we'll follow the mind aspect because the repercussion is more of a gradual, you know, suppression of who we are, and that's not as painful.
It's almost similar, maybe not similar, but along the same lines of what Seth Godin would call the lizard brain. And it's really this element of like, when you're thinking with your head, you go kind of like, what are the negative things? What are the worst case scenarios? You know, like when you hear, oh, the boss wants to talk to you, automatically that transitions to, oh my gosh, I'm going to lose my job. I'm going to be homeless. I'm going to be broke. I'm not going to be able to eat. I'm going to die, right? I'm going to die. I'm good. And so it sounds like it's very similar, like these automatic things that are conditioned from all the stimulus that you've absorbed, all the things you've been taught. It's just, you were saying that most people just naturally flow in that direction?
Yes. Most of us, because, excuse me.
Sure.
I allude to when we're born, we start consuming binders. And binders are anything that's external to our natural being. You won't really know what a binder is until the postmortem, if you will, until you look back. Mm-hmm. Because some things that are seemingly external to us, like someone's encouragement to go on a certain path, may be exactly in line with what our heart deeply loves. So that pressure is not a binder. Mm-hmm. There are things that are put upon us through example, through visual experience and things that we take in that we assume cause and effect. And therefore, you know, we decide not to go that path or to go a certain direction because it'll bring the money or whatever the case may be. And anything that is not in congruency with what we really are about becomes a binder because the fear of the impact of that, it restricts you. And so therefore you never go down the heart route. And what's ironic is for whatever reason, this human journey, it's almost like it's a game. They say the game of life, right? But it's like there's this challenge of most of what is deeply heart-centered for us completely flies in the face of what is considered conventional wisdom. That seems to be the pattern.
Yep.
And so some of the people that have become the most inspiring or most just positive to be around, they're full of transparency and, you know, they're genuine, all these things that we all tend to be driven to. Yeah. They've gone through hell,
right,
to get to that point. And right, the hell has to do with following this thing. And when you look back on the story, you sit there and you go, I would have never made that choice.
Well, right.
That's evidence that you.
Right. And so, yeah, I can see that. And like now thinking through some of the people that I would look to, right, for some inspiration, look to and say like, wow, they've done amazing things. You look at all the things that led them there. Right. And going back, like survival mentality would not have led to any of those decisions. No. Or like, no. What is going to be the make the most sense? You look at people that maybe were very talented in one area but did something different with much success, and you're like, oh well, the parents and the teachers and the advisors and the dollar amount with the salary at the end, all of that said to do this thing, right? But they did something else. They zigged when everyone said they should zag. They pivoted. Right. and right now, like in hindsight, right, everyone says Elon Musk is crazy. Right. Tesla will never work. Now, after 4 quarters of profitability, the story's changing a little bit. Right. And he's just like a very, very like real time example of now you look back like, oh, maybe it was brilliant. Right.
Right.
You look back like,
right,
was it brilliant or is it crazy? And you're saying and it's holding true in my own mind that a lot of the people that we look up to and have done amazing things looked crazy before they looked brilliant.
Yes. And to put it even more simply, the only thing that differentiates the self-made great, and that's a big difference there, if you just inherit fame, or not that fame matters,
yep,
but notoriety or you mm-hmm. inherit money or whatever, that's sure, not the same as. So for the people that are self-made great, the only thing that makes them different than everybody else is connection here. You can't see my finger. Yeah. Connection here.
Connection right, in the heart, yeah.
Followed something. They didn't realize they were doing that, mm-hmm. but despite the fear, the perceived potential repercussions or pain. In other words, here's a good way to gauge how your natural bias is. Then we can talk about the different ways you can choose to adjust it, right? If you want to.
Actually, let me pause you for 1 second right there. Okay. So I want to get back to that, talking about that. But I had a guest on not too long ago, New York Times bestseller Donald Miller. And we talked about a similar thing, you know, and he said, it's suppression, right? And, you know, I didn't grow up in a fundamentalist home. I grew up in a Christian home, but I just didn't have much exposure to, you know, people who had money or CEOs. And there was almost this air of like others, right? Like those are other people. And, you know, and I just grabbing this quick aside. And so it's a very common theme. I think you just brought it up as your experience. I had a similar experience. This other Donald Miller was telling me he had a similar experience, and like turning that around and realizing that like to some get this and some get that, and understanding that how that is handled and stewarded. And he went in, he told a story about somebody saying, well, I would never work for that person. And it was a well-known name in town. He didn't bring it up. And he said, really? He's like, why not? Well, they're just a bad person. They have all this money. And it was because they're so rich. And he said, you see the name on that children's hospital? You know, he said, would you ever go there if your child was sick? You know, and he really just said like, hey, it's not about what you have. It's how you leverage what you've been given to do it. So it's a little bit of a side, but I just wanted to connect with that moment for a second, because what you just said right there is a very important part. And I think is something that a lot of people actually experience, but don't talk about. So just wanted to say that right there. I've heard it, and it's good to hear you say it.
Totally true. And money is energy, and energy can be used for good and for bad.
Yes.
If you got a muscle, I can use it to pull somebody out of an accident, or I can use it to beat somebody's face in.
So, it's a great illustration.
There's good and bad people, so to speak, or good and bad applications of energy. So there's the money that's ugly money. Mm-hmm. It's energy. And we draw money just like we draw all sorts of other energy into our life. But yes, I agree. I was raised believing that money itself, mm-hmm, that's like saying energy is bad. You can't say energy is
strength
bad.
Strength is bad.
Right.
Leverage is bad.
To strangle somebody is bad, yes, but to use it for good is a different thing. So there was that barrier or limitation. So college was not an option. I was surrounded by people that did make, you know, okay incomes, okay for blacks outside of Chicago, if you will. Yep. 50, 60 grand is really good income. Yep. And they were maybe insurance agents. They did financial planning and that. And here's what it comes down to, Paul. Remember I said, what separates people that you admire so much from you in terms of your trajectory is their connection to the heart. And we're all at varying degrees wired to our heart or completely disconnected from it. So the people that have no joy, no, you know, heart connection to their job, they're obviously more disconnected than someone who's a little more. So here's the point. Most of us are wired to follow the mind. And by the way, this also parallels with people saying right brain, left brain. Mm-hmm. 90% of people are right-handed, mm-hmm, 10% are left. Now, that does not mean every right-handed person is, mm-hmm, heart disconnected. Plenty of them are. It's not that way. And it also does not mean every left-handed person will be very heart connected. It means you may have a stronger aptitude to be able to follow your heart or, mm-hmm, to be more mind-driven. I'll connect that a little bit later. But here's the question to ask yourself. When you look back on your experiences and decisions and peer group and job, relationship, you name it, which triggers you the most? Triggers meaning rattles you, gets you a little bit fearful, unnerving. The idea of upsetting your family, culture, tribe, expectations, and I mean upsetting in a big way. I don't mean disagreeing with who's going to win the Super Bowl. I mean like something you will seriously rock the boat with your family, your culture, your career and peers at work, your loved one in a relationship. If you're more triggered by that concern than being in disagreement internally, then you're more right driven. So if you're more worried about upsetting external stuff than you are upsetting your internal self, you're more ego mind driven, and that's the majority of people.
Yep. Yeah. Guilty. Yeah.
that's most. We all are, yep, to varying degrees. So it's not meant to label or put boxes on it, but just know how you're biased.
Indicators. Right. Understanding your own bias. Yep. Well, I think what you just said is evidenced in, I mean, I think it's evidenced in natural law, like the tension produces strength in some way, right? And the trials are what produce perseverance, and that's what produces fortitude and, you know,
right.
Wisdom, right? Wisdom doesn't come from learning here, right? Wisdom comes from experience. Wisdom comes from, you know, right. Seeing, feeling, hearing, experiencing the pain. And so I think that like from the critical point of what I said in the beginning, like having perspective of where you are on the map, because if I were to tell you that, hey, this situation's going to come up, it's going to be really, really hard. You're going to think that everything's going to fall apart, but guess what? It doesn't. And you're going to be in a better place as a result. If you could know and believe that at the very beginning of the situation, you would have a totally different situation.
And it wouldn't serve you.
It wouldn't do anything for you.
It's kind of like laying on the bench at the gym and putting no weight on it.
Right, exactly.
The muscle doesn't get stronger.
And so, right, so exactly. So that is why we need, and like we've seen this in ancient texts, you know, like I come at, like because I grew up Christian, I studied the Bible, like that principle you talked about right there is all throughout that text, all throughout. People, things looking one way, only to realize it actually was a whole other thing at work. And I've seen it in my own life. I see it in other people's lives. Like you're telling us about it from your perspective right now. How should someone know, like, this is being placed on me, or this is how I authentically feel? Like, how do you make the difference? I feel like that's the million-dollar question.
Yes. Well, it's always there. So to give you, so which one feels natural versus which one feels externally placed? So you've, to give you an example, let's shift it into love. I make a point in the book that no one has ever been dumped. You are never dumped.
A lot of people that are saying no way right now.
They're saying, yes, I have. They lied to me all that time and I thought they were great and they just left. Every single person, there's probably 100 people I've asked this question to, when they've truly let down their victim mindset of I've been done wrong, or that the story they want to tell themselves, and you just ask them, were you really completely blindsided, right? Where you're telling me, because we all call a relationship a connection. Don't mm-hmm. we call it a connection? Mm-hmm. Connection is energy. Energy is either connected and the circuit is going through, zip, 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 or it isn't.
Mm-hmm.
When that connection is not a connection, it's impossible for only one side to know about it. The issue is only one side chooses to acknowledge or do something about it or take action, but you've already known that the vibe, the frequency, the connection is lacking and you are forcing it. You already know you're exposed, not because the person wants to do you wrong, but because something isn't as strong as you think it is or you want it to be, but you'd rather have that instead of nothing else, or you'd rather just ignore it, and so you keep pushing through it. Nobody who's really been dumped will ever tell you that they may be so wrapped up in their narrative that they'll at first say yes, 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 because they've been telling themselves this loud this time. Then when they slow down enough,
yep,
and they go back through the steps, they go, yeah, at this stage I had a doubt.
Yeah,
at this stage I wondered about that. The point is, you know.
Right.
But you're right. It is a challenge to train yourself.
In the moment you don't.
In the moment you don't consciously
correct.
Know.
Right.
In your body, energetically, you know. And the purpose of the book is exactly that point. How do you look back on all these experiences, these lessons that have been banging you on the head, mm-hmm. your own lessons, it's not a bio of me, it's not a memoir.
Mm-hmm.
There's a couple stories of me, but it's largely taking you through real life stuff mm-hmm. and helping you analyze your energy in the experience, your energy back then, your energy now, and even your energy looking at your future, because mm-hmm. your future has an energy, it has a disposition based upon how you perceive it, and learning, what am I being told that I'm not really heeding? And then when you start to heed it, you go, oh, that feels more comfortable to just accept this. Scary as shit, because I don't know what the outcome over here is, because I was cowering to this energy because of the logical world around me.
Mm-hmm.
But that's exactly when you become your strongest, because you're lifting the weight, so to speak, mm-hmm. of your own journey of like being able to embody your own truth. And that's why you become more successful, more fulfilled, better relationships, more inspirational. That's why those people are what they are.
Fantastic. Well, look, it's going to take me a while to just even think through this interview because we talked about, like you said, some things that are really deep. Right. It's a lot of stuff. But I mean, a lot of it does resonate in the sense, and from experience and just my current thinking, and just trying to get perspective on why I do what I do, right? And is it being driven by outside influences on me, or is it something that I genuinely believe and genuinely want out of life and want for the better?
Love or fear?
Love or fear.
That's all it is. It's one of those two. And you may say, well, no, but it is. I have a chapter that talks about our careers and money, and we don't realize that when we're very successful with money, often it's because we're scared of money.
Yep. No, it's very, you know, the love and fear thing, right? When there's an expression of love, a genuine expression of love, an authentic, what does it do? Well, it pushes fear aside and does some very unconventional things. Look, I hope that people connect with you after this podcast. What's the best way for people to stay connected with you?
My website, unboundedbook.com. The same website as aaronmccormick.com.
Great. We'll make sure we link everything up. The book is available on Amazon, so everyone can get it just about everywhere. Aaron, again, thank you for sharing your insights and your life of wisdom with us and you know, contributing your vibe to this podcast and to the audience. I appreciate it so much.
You too, Paul. Thanks for doing this. You help a lot of people. I appreciate that as well.
So that final point, analyzing your experience. If I sum up everything we talked about, my takeaway from it was this concept of analyzing my own experience and analyzing it in light of even the hard things or actually things that move me forward in who I want to be as a man, who I want to be as a person, who I want to be as a professional, who I want to be as a father. I talk about this in terms of, I call it the transaction of growth, and that the natural world around us, everything says, well, growth takes pain. Growth takes struggle. And if you don't struggle, then you don't grow. So really, his take is very similar to my belief on that. And I think very similar to the principles that we all know in our own lives, that the things that were very hard for us are actually the things that end up being the things that make us grow the most. So whatever you are going through today that is difficult or have just gone through that is difficult, may you reanalyze that and look at it with the perspective of that is something that made you better, stronger, wiser, more experienced. And may you take all that understanding, take some of the pressure off of what you should be, what you should believe, and may you move forward with a little more clarity and a little more freedom so that you can serve others. I hope you have an amazing week. I hope you're staying close to the people that you care about in these tumultuous times. I hope you're out there speaking the truth. I hope you're out there serving other people and loving other people, especially those that you disagree with. Have a great week. I can't wait to see you next week. Talk to you soon.